Mittal, on the other hand, is the BJP being a shade too arrogant? And as are some of the regional leaders today in dismissing the Congress out of hand. 6 months ago, Nitish Lalu, Congress, famous victory in Bihar. I mean, let's be clear, every election is different to the other. You had a great day in office, but there seems to be this triumphalism that should worry you come the next election in UP, where who knows, Mayawati may well be the queen of the day.
Rajdeep, we are discussing as we stand today. Congress was ruling in 8 states. Today they've been reduced to 6. And if you look at the total number of Lok Sabha, which are represented in the 6 states, it's 42 only. So naturally, if that is the state of Congress, we are bound to point it out. But more importantly, I want to point out the enormity of the victory of Assam. Do you realize that in 2011, we just had 5 seats. Today we are 50 plus. It's a tenfold increase in last 5 years. That's the enormity of the
It's a remarkable win. It's a remarkable win in Assam.
It's not that we were second. It's not that we were second and then we have suddenly come first. No, we were always a peripheral player, and within 5 years, from being a peripheral player, we are now heading the government there, which is phenomenal. Because I've been hearing all kind of things from the Congress spokespersons and everything. Two things which have gone in favor of BJP. One is the negative politics of Congress. Two things. One is the corruption and the kind of politics they practiced to shield Bangladeshi voters. They had always capitalized on the presence of Bangladeshis in Assam, which has actually changed the entire demography of Assam. Today they have a 34% Muslim population. And this is just the official figure. Unofficially, it's more. And concentrated, there are 9 districts today which are Muslim majority districts. And this is, read it, this is largely Bangladeshi Muslim majority districts. This negative politics of playing on communal politics has costed.
I take your point, Sudhanshu. You believe that the Congress's votes base, the traditional, the manner in which they played politics in Assam has taken a beating, and therefore it's a huge triumph and no one should undermine it. 5 seats going up to 50 and plus, maybe even 60 eventually in Assam, along with AGP and the Bodoland People's Front. Clear majority, exactly what we predicted in our exit polls this time. Let me take a break at this point. We'll return with plenty more. Sum up what's been a fascinating day again in Indian politics. Every election day throws up some surprises. The big surprise, of course, Amma beating anti-incumbency there in Tamil Nadu. But overall, what a day again in Indian politics. There are big winners and there are, of course, some.
Sudhanshu Mittal of the BJP is joining us as we see these images of celebration at the Ashoka Road offices of the Bharatiya Janata Party. And after 2 big electoral routs, finally the BJP and Amit Shah have something to be smiling about, Sudhanshu.
You see, the routs were always then attributed to Narendra Bhai and Amit Ji. So rightfully now, the victory in Assam should also be attributed to them. And, we must congratulate them. I don't think the enormity of the victory has really got registered. In 2011, Rahul, we were just 5. And today we are 85. I mean, look at the quantum jump in the last 5 years we've had. It's been just too phenomenal. And if I was to attribute this success, apart from the 2 people I mentioned, Sarbananda Sonwal, a very soft, very likable, and a face who had fought for the IMDT. You see, you must understand that Bangladeshi Bangladeshi infiltration issue was always an issue in the eyes of the people of Assam. But because there was lack of credibility in terms of the political establishment there, it had lost its relevance. But because Sarbananda Sonwal was there, and he's a man who fought the IMDT case in the Supreme Court and got Supreme Court to support, to strike down the act. So again, it raised hope that there'll be an effective check on the Bangladeshi infiltration. Ram Madhav, as the overall in charge, has played a phenomenal role. He's strategized it, he's overseen it, he's brought everybody together. He was that central authority which was required to win an election of this kind, where the history was against us. Then we had Mahinder Singh, who is again the in charge of Assam. And Hemanta Biswa Sarma, as somebody who excels in electioneering, I mean, I
so
must
what
say
happens now, Sudhanshu, to Hemanta Biswa Sarma? Will he stay and work in Assam, or when the cabinet reshuffle happens, if it does, and whenever it does, he'll be brought back, because you don't want somebody as dangerous as a Hemanta Biswa Sarma trying to stay at the same place. He wasn't okay playing second fiddle to Tarun Gogoi. Why should he be okay playing second fiddle to Sarbanda Sonowal?
Rahul, the context of Congress was entirely different. There, it was again a family tree which was in the line of succession. A person who naturally was the second choice to Tarun Gogoi was sought to be bypassed by Gaurav Gogoi. So the family patronage was what created all that, but that's not the issue. Issue is we've all fought it together. Fani Sharma, who's the organizing secretary, you won't believe the amount of travel he did across the length and breadth. I mean, these people have for the last so many years, I mean, they've really converted the state into an amazing state for BJP, and mind it, you know, there are 25 seats, Lok Sabha seats in the Seven Sisters. BJP drew a blank or 3-2, whatever. The most significant part of this victory is that we are now poised for a major chunk of these 25 seats. So from the Lok Sabha perspective and point of view also, it is such a tremendous boost.
Okay.
And I'm
stay
sure
with me, Sudhanshu. I want to go across to Pratibha Ramanji, joining us right outside Poise Garden, where Jai Jai Lalita emerged for the first time ever since this big victory. She was very, very humble, or at least
a question to
Rahul, the fact of the matter is we've never been a player in Tamil Nadu. We've never been a player in Kerala. We've never been a player in West Bengal. And so we have reasons to be satisfied in terms of opening our accounts in Kerala as well as West Bengal. We've done fairly well. And this thing, one more thing, you have Pradeep Gupta there. Mr. Gupta and I had a word day before yesterday.
Yeah.
And he was very tentative about Tamil Nadu. He said, look, I'm very confident about all the other polls, but I'm not too confident about what we have discovered about Tamil Nadu. And well, his apprehension is right. I was also putting him to close scrutiny on Assam. And he held to his ground. He's 79, and I'm so grateful that he held on to that, because, you know, BJP had launched a mission called Mission 84. In Lok Sabha, after Lok Sabha, we had 69 seats out of the 126 in Lok Sabha. Vidhan Sabha.
Bayanidhi Maran is speaking at this time. I'm just listening to what he's saying. I'm coming back to you, Sudhanshu, in a moment. Welcome back. You're watching our continuing coverage of the big assembly election results. We've got breaking news coming in now from Assam, where the BJP is just too short. Pradeep Gupta is telling us from a full majority.
Yes, yeah.
Incredible for a party which was nowhere in the reckoning so far, going very close to a full majority by itself.
Sudhanshu ji,
yes.
Sudhanshu ji, badaiyo aapko, aap do short hai majority se.
We've also got Babul Supriya joining us. This is a very, very big achievement for the BJP, because they're just too short now for full majority by itself. Pawan Verma of the JDU and Babul Supriya, Union Minister, is now with us. I want to go across to Babul because he comes from the state of West Bengal. He's the MP from Asansol. While the BJP did reasonably well in terms of vote share in the West Bengal elections, in the general elections of 2014, you haven't been able to build on that this time. You've got 7 seats, but not the kind of inroads you were hoping to make, Babul.
Well, Rahul, you know, it's ultimately in a democracy is the people's verdict which reigns supreme. So in the national perspective, I would just like to say that, you know, it's a huge win in Assam. I believe we are going to get those 2 that is needed right now. And we have just heard Mamata Banerjee saying that she's going to extend her support to BJP in the center based on issues. So I think in terms of the central politics, we are in a very good spot. We have not really lost anything. In terms of Bengal, yes. The issues that I have against, that we have against Trinamool as a political party, the issues that are same as what Trinamool would have against other parties. So the issues do not change. The facts that we have laid down while we were campaigning, they don't change. The only thing that changes is the fact that Trinamool has got a thumping victory which has to be respected. And therefore, I just hope that as one of the 2 MPs from Bengal, my work in Asansol is going to be helped by Didi, and we are not going to meet any political blocks.
Okay, but why do you think the script for the BJP in West Bengal did not build on the leads of 2014. Your party managed to pick up a fair amount of votes in 2014. You were hoping to consolidate on that, but all of that seems to have been washed aside by the Mamata tsunami.
Well, Rahul, I wouldn't be able to comment on that because, you know, I was just as a diligent party member. I just did the campaigning. I was not part of the strategy making. You'll have to ask my senior leaders, whether it is Kailash Vijayvargi ji or Siddharth Nath Singh, who were the observer and co-observer. And of course, the party leaders here, Rahul Sinha, they are the ones who were the strategists. They are the ones who formulated everything. I just did as I was expected and asked to do. I can't say more on that, but definitely,
okay, I think
it's time everyone has to, as a political party, you'll have to sit down and think why the corruption issue did not work in West Bengal, why the development issue that is happening everywhere in India did not work in West Bengal, why we were not making any false statements, the Sharda, Narda, or whether it is the bomb issues, NIA, Khagragar, they were all true facts. So why is corruption a non-issue in Bengal? Is development is something that does not excite people in Bengal anymore? So these are questions that, as a political party, we'll have to address and answer. But
no,
that
I have a theory. The theory essentially is this,
yeah,
that the sadak pani, bijli, development work of Mamata Banerjee seems to have prevailed over the Narda Sarda scams. And as Javed said, maybe corruption isn't quite as big an issue for voters as it is at least for TV channels and amongst the intelligentsia. Pavan Verma of the JDU is also with us, because in the past few days we've seen Nitish Kumar make multiple moves to try and project himself as a possible opponent to Modi in 2019. With the kind of victories that Mamata Banerjee and Jai Jai Lalita have, does that really complicate things for Nitish Kumar? Because these leaders can say, we have won all by ourselves. Nitish Kumar wins riding piggyback with Lalu Yadav. How does he get to be an opponent to Modi and not us?